senior man, and as you know, in one of our electives, we have knowledge management. And as ma'am said, you know, we'll be also taking a lot of sessions which are in the electives. You may not have choose to be part of the students who will write a paper on that, but as you know, everything is interconnected. But knowledge management and logic, part of the same, is very, very important even for decision making. So as you know, we have a full paper on decision making. But today, ma'am, will be taking this particular lecture on knowledge and decision making. I don't want to give any formal introduction. We are part of our team anyways. And since you know her, take us to ma'am.
Did we meet earlier? Yes.
Yes.
Same one. I was wondering, but somehow I'm not able to recollect all faces. So Dr. Joshi must have talked to you about knowledge and epistemology, etc. We will have other discussion in continuation with the same. But as per your requirement, we have the topic like knowledge and decision making. So before entering into that, yeah, this is on epistemology. And this is very technical.
What
is the epistemology? Yeah, it is the theory of knowledge. Episteme means knowledge. And as we all know, logi or logos means a systematic study. So it comes as the science of knowledge. And what it covers is the idea of the person involved, the object of knowledge involved, the sources of knowledge, maybe our idea of what is knowledge and what is not knowledge. So we can start from there, because we may have certain idea about knowledge. And today when I was leaving the house in the morning, that news was flashing there. I am sure all of you are Spain.
Barcelona.
Barcelona was yesterday. yesterday only. No, this is related to industry. Are all of you related to industry or no?
Yes.
Yeah. So there was some news there that Vishal Sikka was transferred to
resign,
and he was made some executive director. No? Yeah. Yeah. What do we think about it? Why could it happen? Or what may be the reason?
He did not gel.
He did not gel with the... Okay.
With the consultant.
His letter has also been published.
Okay.
Not with the shareholder, particularly the chairman.
Yeah. The ex-chairman. Enforces. He has mentioned also in the letter that there have been a lot of interventions in his working and all. There's a lot of disturbance, and so then he preferred to.
Anything else?
Cultural shift, probably generational gap is there now.
So what is the issue around
CEO of Infosys?
Vishal Sikka is no more the CEO of
Infosys.
Yeah.
He resigned. And board is accepted immediately.
Okay,
anyway. This board did a press conference in the afternoon as well. So they did like 40 minutes press conference explaining their stand on the board.
Now when these things happen, how do we categorize something as knowledge about it and something like some other factor? Maybe like opinion. What he said just now.
So basically the ex-chairman and this person did not agree on most of the decisions taken.
So there is possibility of disagreement.
Yes.
Is there any possibility of disagreement related to knowledge?
Yes.
No.
Are you getting my question?
See, if it
what
is a
I'm
fact,
trying to ask
if
you.
If it is a fact, there is no disagreement. If it is a view, there can be a disagreement.
Yeah, so how do we differentiate between knowledge, information and opinion?
So what is
knowledge will be based on facts?
Facts.
So what is said now is an information. There must be some undercurrent. There must be some different truth behind the scene which we don't know.
So information is not truth.
No, information is.
Information can be right or wrong.
Then information is I'm knowing about something. Knowledge is about having a complete study of the background of things. And perception is just trying to gauge and making an assumption.
So knowledge can be true or false, but information can be true or false, but knowledge has to be.
Way of explaining knowledge may be different, that will take to the sort of information.
So do we have knowledge or do we have way of explaining knowledge?
Way of explaining.
We have knowledge.
Do we have knowledge?
Can we interpret it? Knowledge is
information. Knowledge is something which we have. It's always interpreted and it's always relative. Like Galileo said that sun is in center and earth moves around, which was not accepted because he went against Bible. So at that time the knowledge was that earth is in center and sun moves around. Okay, but then he went against. So that's relative.
So verified information will be knowledge?
Yeah. Anything related to code of conduct?
Code of conduct. That is knowledge?
Having knowing that there are this many data points is my information. Using those data points and coming out of a conclusion out of it is knowledge. And assuming something that it can be something like this, that is perception or assumption.
So accepted data should be knowledge.
Now, among all these things, what should I take as knowledge, information and opinion? if there is only one knowledge, why should there be jhagda? Can there be such kind of dispute about knowledge or information or opinion?
See, we were giving interpretation of
information can be true or false.
We are not giving actually knowledge. So that is why the difference is there.
Information can be varied to true or false, misleading, you know. That can be colored. And the dispute, you said, knowledge cannot be
disputed.
Knowledge is established.
So can we have some concrete example, one example of all these things? One example of knowledge, one example of information, and one example of opinion.
Knowledge will be sun is round.
Yes.
Sun is round.
Sun rises in east and sets in west.
That's knowledge is that India is a republic.
That's information.
Information is wrong. India's population is 150 crore. Is an information. Knowledge is that India is among the second largest, most populated country in the world. Doing a comparative analysis with all others is giving me a knowledge about it. And my opinion is maybe India is poor country. That can be just an opinion because there is no matrix, there is no analytical.
Okay. So, other smaller examples.
So, information is that information is Barcelona mein bomb babo van ghus gaya. That is information. And opinion is somebody did it for X, Y, Z reason. That is an opinion.
Can't
knowledge is knowing probably where Barcelona is.
Haji?
Can't that be a piece of information?
No. Who has done it and why they have done it is not a information. That is opinion. That is definitely opinion.
So what will be the criteria for deciding?
When the knowledge gets narrated from one person to another, then it becomes an information. And the opinion or the comment of that person on that knowledge is an opinion.
Okay.
highly subjective statement and very personal. Whereas knowledge is extrinsic. Information happens to be a part of that knowledge, of the entire awareness. So information is basically a subset of knowledge and both are extrinsic. However, an opinion is very intrinsic.
So whatever is intrinsic, can we decide it to be true or false? Can our opinion be true or false?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No.
Opinion is opinion. For me, that is a fact.
Opinion changes with me from one person to the other. How can there be true or false?
Opinion is
after
all is individual.
So is it true or false?
Yes.
Or can we decide it to be true or false?
No.
Both opinions can be.
Opinion is a judgment.
Opinion probably is true only for the person who is giving the opinion.
So can there be truth for a person? Can there be truth for an individual?
Yes.
We can believe that it's a truth. On the basis of that belief, you have an opinion.
Actually, the exam is true. The teacher can decide.
I know the right answer. You gave me only 2 marks. According to you, that was the right answer.
So can there be truth according to me?
Yes.
Then it is not a truth.
Yeah, correct. It's not a truth.
Then what it is?
It's not a truth. You are right.
It's a viewpoint.
It's a point of view. It's a belief.
So many things about knowledge, etc.
Truth is basically linked with knowledge.
Okay. So knowledge may be connected with the truth.
Yeah.
But that's a fact.
Fact.
Yeah, it's a fact. It's an established fact.
So something, what we have as the basic idea about knowledge is that it is related to fact. Is mathematics related to fact?
Yes. Yes.
Fact or
because,
numbers?
Because numbers, but
both. 4 plus 1 is equal to 2.
But is it a fact?
But there can't be opinion in mathematics.
Fact is something you cannot disapprove or you cannot negate.
Fact.
It's a fact. So 1 plus 1 is 2. You cannot prove it wrong.
See, when we say fact. Fact is something related to the world, isn't it?
Yes, reality.
So is there any factual content in mathematics?
Yes. No, numerical. Numerical.
Factual.
And what do we mean by fact then?
Fact is...
2 plus 2 is fact.
But a number can be a fact.
See, 2 plus 2 can be truth, but is it a fact?
What is the difference between truth and fact then?
A number can be a fact. No? A distance between this place and this place is a number, and that is a fact.
Why I am asking this question?
Yeah.
We have certain views
it can
about
be, yeah,
knowledge.
You said 10
and when
steps.
No, I would listen.
No, sorry.
No problem. Particularly when you are reading this slide and we are talking about knowledge. And we may have this idea that there is something called knowledge of one type. But it is not necessary that what we call as knowledge may be of one type only. So there can be knowledge like formal disciplines, like mathematics or logic. We can show this as one and we say, oh, is it not a fact? But number one has nothing to do with this fact. It's a number. And all the other numbers in a way are constructed, isn't it? Again we can show this. This is 2. But again, number 2 has nothing to do with these things. It's a number. And if you have done some higher mathematics, you know about it. That whatever we learn in mathematics, the learning process can be related to the things. But mathematics itself is not related to the things in the world. It is the relation between the numbers. So multiplication, division, etc. These are all formula. And then once we learn the formula and the interrelation between the numbers, we learn mathematics. Then we don't have to count the beads to know that this is 8. Then remove the 2 from that, this remains 6. This is all psychology of learning mathematics. But this is not mathematics. Knowing mathematics means not counting the beads and then finding out the numbers. Knowing the mathematics is to play with those numbers, formula, and the interrelation between the numbers.
Geometry is also mathematics. It also knows in then how only numbers?
Whatever. See, anything in the mathematics will have its own subject matter. So when you say geometry, fine. What do you study in geometry?
Lines
and shapes. So for example, we say triangle. And then in fact also we have many triangular shapes. And we know the types of triangles, etc. But all these types of triangles, the types of triangles, something, classification, is not what mathematics, geometry is dealing with. Geometry is dealing with the concept of triangle. So little abstract. So someone will say, okay, draw a triangle. And we will draw a triangle on the board. It will certainly fit in some category. Isn't it? Right angle triangle. I'm sure you are not bored. No? Geometry we all remember.
Yes.
So something like this. And someone will say, no, I don't want this. I just want a triangle. That is not possible. See, triangle, example of triangle will be of some type or the other. But geometry is not talking about any type of triangle. Geometry is talking about the concept of triangle. So mathematics of any type, that means algebra. See, algebra, there are no shapes and these. Algebra is something different. So all those categories of mathematics, they are very abstract type of disciplines. Similarly, logic. Logic is also abstract. It talks about the laws of thought. Now we know everything is identical to itself. Everything is identical to itself. This is first law of thought. But this is to be articulated. We think on these lines, but someone has to create the science of law, and that is logic. So logic will not consider what at this particular time I am thinking. But logic will give us the model of thought. So this is something that can be called as the abstract knowledge. These are the disciplines for abstract knowledge. Now is it true? Again we came to truth. Huh? Is it true? What logic is saying, is it true or not? Or what mathematics is saying, is it true or not?
Yes,
it is true.
Yeah, because if we calculate the numbers properly, it is true. That is how we master the subject. But is it a fact?
Everybody is afraid of.
Everybody is afraid of the word fact. But it is a very simple thing. Fact is something that happens in the world. And truth is not something that happens in the world. Truth is maybe the characteristic of what is there in the world. Now what is there in the world, it can be some event, it can be something, or it can be something abstract like concept or any other thing. So truth is the adjective. And fact is something that actually takes place. Yeah, it could be. Fact is a fact. See, fact is not true or false. Fact is a fact. What we say about fact becomes true or false. Now this is something bouncer?
Yes.
Or
it's again.
So can we say, ma'am, that truth is what exists in the world?
characteristic of the thing that exists in the world. See, true. See, if you remember little bit language grammar, in our school papers, examination papers, we used to have that question, no? State whether following statements are true or false. So truth is the characteristic of a statement. In a very simple type, in a very simple manner, what we say can be true or false. But what actually takes place is what actually takes place. That's it. Isn't it? So you are watching, if you remember that whole channel show, the Twin Towers came down.
Yeah.
That's a fact. So my saying is also not a fact. Actually, those Twin Towers coming down is a fact. Now what we say about it, it becomes its description, maybe evaluation, maybe something else, opinion. If it is opinion, there is no question of truth and false, because opinion is opinion. It is the subjective expression. My opinion is true for me. That is why it is my opinion. Otherwise, it has no meaning for me. So for me, it is like a final truth. But it is not a final truth for some other person. And that itself shows that opinion is very personal, subjective expression about any fact. But we leave it aside from knowledge, because it is beyond the categorization of truth and falsity. What we call as knowledge must have some minimum conditions. It must have truth. And it must be my, it must be first of all, it must be held by me to be true. So I am the possessor of that. It belongs to me. But if I go like this, it will be very technical, like a philosophy. Let's go little. Yeah, but that also. Wait. Then we will come. Yes, this is something interesting. Actually, the word, Sanskrit word, pramanam, is used for knowledge. And that word has some other connotations. We have lot of information thanks to the internet. So if you open the site, if you open any website or any site, you will get huge information. Is it all part of my knowledge? Is it my knowledge?
It is information.
Yeah, so it is data. If I get the data and if I understand it and if I know what to do of it, then that means I start intellectually working on it. I start processing that data. This process makes that data my knowledge. So when that data is internalized, when that data is undertaken by me, and then I know how to use it, where to use it, where to avoid it, or then maybe truth and falsity of that, authenticity of that, then it becomes part of my understanding, my knowledge. So there must be some possessor for knowledge. In Sanskrit, I am sure we all know some Indian languages. So a good word for this kind of distinction is Vidya. See, earlier we used to know Vidya is not knowledge only. Vidya means store knowledge. Store knowledge.
Knowledgeable.
Store. It is like a store. So science is like Vidya, because it is not possessed by anyone.
Can knowledge be stored, only information can be stored?
But data.
Data can be stored, but the interpretation of data which we say.
Yes, but technically it means a store. And there is this idea that there is always the growth in knowledge. We can measure the growth. See, science can be measured, no? What was physics at the time of Newton, Einstein, and what is physics today? Is something increasing,
so like by
maybe growing.
By innovation, we, that bank is filled with
knowledge. So it is a bank. Vidya means a knowledge bank. And it can be measured as a growth in knowledge. But this bank doesn't belong to anyone as such. Whosoever can approach can get the benefit of that. So even though there are inventions with the name of scientist, that particular law, that particular theory doesn't belong to that. That means there is no patenting like that.
When universal?
It is universal. And it is open to all. Not only universal, it is open to all. But what we call as knowledge, which is the subject matter for our lecture today, it is not just a bank. Maybe from some bank, we have taken out something for us. And now we are using it, maybe for something or for creating something else. We are processing all that. So we are the person in the whole process of knowledge is very important. And this person can acquire lot of information which is in the form of data, but what is to be ascertained by the person is the truth of that data. Truth is the objective condition. Is it raining outside?
It is information, yeah.
Yeah, so if we say it's raining outside, this is information.
If you are saying it, it is not information.
Knowledge. I process the data.
Now we know many words and how to play with the words, no? Suppose it's not raining outside. Now, is it true because we are saying it, or is it true independently?
It's true independently.
It is not dependent on us. So this is what is the status of truth. Truth doesn't depend upon whether I like it or not. Truth is independent of my conviction. Truth is independent of my opinion or like and dislike. So in that sense, truth is the objective condition. Something is not true because I want it to be true.
Can be
our
opinion about the person also.
That's true. So opinions are very dangerous. If we mix them with knowledge, they are very dangerous. And if we work on opinions, then it is bound to be like a collapse of everything that we are constructing.
But decisions are only taken on opinion,
on knowledge.
Acquiring all the knowledge, okay, then you analyze it and then you take a decision. So that's a viewpoint.
See, I don't belong to industry. I belong to this poor field of knowledge. So I can give you a theory. You can use it smartly for anything that you are working with. But what he says, that is a new data for me. So let us hold it for some time.
Correct. So it is taken on the basis of the facts. So decision is taken on opinion.
It will fall in the domain of knowledge. Right?
Opinion is analyzed on their knowledge and
let us say, when Rama was there, he sent Sita to exile.
Sita?
To exile. To the forest. Now he accumulated all the data. Based on the data he acquired, he had a view or an opinion that she should go. For whatever may the reasons. So he did not take a decision based on the data. He took a decision based on his viewpoint.
The decision is taken on the basis of a purpose and emotion.
Let her complete.
Opinion can be emotionally driven, and that, you know, the person may not take facts or knowledge into consideration when he's giving he or she is giving opinion. So that is the range that's more than the range of opinion.
Okay, before Ashwati comes, one just important, what ma'am said. See, there are two things we need to be clear. One is pure knowledge and applied knowledge. And if you know in the field of science, also there is something called as pure science and applied science. These two are different. The difference is so beautifully that if you look at the industry, knowledge is for application. If you look at the R&D department at apparel companies, so why do they make knowledge? Why? Application में कुछ ना कुछ profitability होना चाहिए, that's the main. But she said something very nice, where I come from the world of knowledge, knowledge for the sake of knowledge. So application हो नहीं हो, doesn't matter. So if you go to certain places where pure science is being researched, they don't think इसका benefit क्या होगा. For example, if you look at TIFR, you know what is TIFR? Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. If you go to meet those scientists, उनको पूछो ये क्या कर रहे हो, अगर ये कर रहा हूँ, क्यों कर रहे हो? So what they are saying,
that question is irrelevant for them.
Exactly. Now you start looking at your perspective. See, what we need to understand, what she said, is that if you look at these terminologies, are concepts, first of all, why are these concepts so abstract? We have been trained that every knowledge should be applied. That's unfortunate, especially in Bombay. So what is happening is that what she's trying to drive a point is that few bounds are there and give knowledge for the sake of knowledge. Full stop. We have been trained knowledge for the sake of something, isn't it? So look at from this dimension, then you will start understanding the basically knowledge ke bhi dimensions hai. You getting my point?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. So I understand from where they are coming, I understand where you are coming from. Okay, please.
Yes. So we were talking about that truth. And what we said at the end was, truth is something like the objective condition which doesn't depend on us. But there is one more condition for categorizing knowledge as different from mere information or mere opinion, is that justification. Do we have justification for our knowledge? When I say it's not raining outside, this may be piece of information, this may be some fact, but if I say this, that it's not raining outside, on what basis I am saying this?
Pratyaksha.
Oh, you know Pratyaksha Praman. Very good. But Pratyaksha Praman will show me that it's raining outside. Pratyaksha Praman will not show me that it is not raining outside. Will it? Pratyaksha Pramana, show me the absence of anything.
What is the Pratyaksha Pramana?
Perception. Forget. If we are not in that technical, forget about it. So justification. And justification means the ground to take it to be true. On what basis that particular thing is regarded to be true by me? I must have the acceptance for that truth. So what we call as knowledge is a combination of two conditions. One, which is lying outside, objective condition. And one, the confirmation from my side, that is the internal condition. When these two together are there, then only that particular piece can be called as knowledge. It cannot be only information. If it is only information, it will be only external.
Yes.
But at the same time, it cannot be opinion only. Because if it is only opinion, it will be only internal condition, disconnected to the external one. So knowledge must necessarily be the combination of external and internal. This is very genuine about knowledge. So now you can analyze your knowledges and you are free to do that, you must do that. But this slide, it shows us something about the dimensions of a human person. Now, as this concept of knowledge tells us, the person in this process is very important. It is like a triad. On one hand, there is a person. On the other side, there is the object of knowledge. And when the interaction between the two takes place, the resulting product is knowledge. So there must be a person, there must be object, and the interaction between the two leads to knowledge. So there is one pramata, which is the subject person involved, a conscious being, not a stone, not a tabula rasa, means blank slate, but a living person. On the other side, there is some object that a person is knowing. It could be anything. It could be a non-living object. It could be some event. It could be some interesting movie. Anything. Anything can be the object of knowledge. But these two independent things, when they come together, some kind of interaction takes place. Do we receive the things blankly, or do we also contribute?
Yes.
Depends.
Uh-huh. At present, what are you doing?
You're just accepting.
Accepting? Grasping. Very good word.
Trying.
Is grasping only receiving?
No.
Trying.
Understanding.
Trying.
Internal understanding.
So think about it. See, I'm not expecting that you will talk very expert on this subject in the first 1 hour only. But think about it. Are we the passive receiver?
No.
Yes. Who said no? You also active, said no.
Active
and you also said we are.
We are active receivers.
Yeah. Active receivers. So active receiving means we are also contributing something.
Yes.
Yeah.
This could be contribution in the form of thought, maybe understanding. See, is our mind a mirror for the reality?
Yes.
If it is a mirror for reality, then there is no contribution.
Okay, so it's a sponge.
If it is like a tissue paper,
it's a sponge.
There is a contribution.
Yeah.
See, don't take these examples literally, because we stick to the examples only and we miss out the spirit. But if it is a mirror, see, mirror doesn't give anything additional to the object. Our mind is very living substance, very lively thing. So it doesn't receive anything like a mirror, but it shapes the object. Our mind shapes whatever it comes to it. So a living person on one hand, and the object that is there, which has lot of things to contribute, is on the other. And when these two come together, some very interesting interaction takes place. Some give and take is there. We want something. So we have to analyze all these three factors. what is the role of the person, what is the role of object, and what is the nature of knowledge as such. And then we can see that there is no one single theory about it. There are various paradigms which are talking about this whole process. Knowledge or knowing something is not just seeing or hearing and then that's it. Many things are happening maybe beneath all that surface process. And therefore, we are all of us are subject to that. And therefore, see, we are all, we do have all this. Do we know? Do we know our potential? So, this is the analysis of a single person. Who is a person? Or who is the one who is worthy of knowledge? In a very plain sense. Worthy doesn't mean religiously worthy, morally worthy. No. Who is the official or what we say, chartered knower? Is the table knower?
No.
Why?
No life,
one process.
No life. Yeah, good. So we know that for a person who knows or for the knower, the minimum condition is that life. Because that is how we respond. Giving response to the thing which comes in our contact is the basic condition. But this kind of response can be given by animals,
yes.
By plants,
yes.
Are they knowers?
Yes.
Yeah, they are knowers.
Yes, they are.
Okay.
Please.
So they can decide the truth?
Yes.
No.
But they can help us in deriving truth.
They have some knowledge absorbed inside them, which they react to, but they cannot share that knowledge. They cannot interact.
No, but they can help us.
They cannot interact.
Huh.
There has been an experiment also that with the trees, that when the murderer comes, the trees have a particular type of sensation, and they are able to identify. And a person who is not a murderer, when he comes, the trees come. And they do attach to them, to that tree, certain electronic instruments and all those things are attached. And then from that experiment, they found that the tree reacts to the person who is a murderer and a non-murderer. That way.
So giving, yes? Giving reaction is a basic sign of a living object, living being. But all of them are not on the same footing. Because all that we know is, animals and plants are working on their natural instincts. Food, or maybe rest, sleep, then death, fear of death. And to some extent, sex passion. These are very common conditions of living. And they are called as the natural instincts. Are we living with natural instincts only?
No. We have a brain.
We have a brain. That is how we spoiled everything. That is what people say. That made the human person very ambiguous. Yeah. Not here, not there, and then
we process and we decide.
We have identity crisis. But we are animals. So we do have natural instincts. But we control the natural instincts. And then we go against the natural instincts to take some decisions. For example, hunger. If animal is hungry, animal will search food and eat. But we decide to remain hungry for a particular day. That is what we call as fast.
Yes.
So we feel hunger. But we decide to control hunger. This is what is called as going beyond our natural instinct. And animals and plants cannot do this. So their life is driven with the natural instincts. But there will be some major difference between plants and animals also. And what could be that? Are they alike?
No.
Are animals and plants alike?
Plants can't move, animals can move.
Yes. So, plants will have less kind of knowledge about the world. And animals, because they can move from place to place, they can be smarter than the plants in reaction to the stimuli. But along with this, there is one major difference is expression. Plants don't make the noise, sound. Even though they show their inclinations, maybe they respond, they don't make the sound. Animals can express their emotions through the sounds. And in the level of consciousness, that is very great difference. We can identify what animal is trying to communicate. But unless we have that kind of training, we may not be able to know what plant is communicating. So animals' sounds, they can be interpreted according to us. So anger of animal, anger of cat, or love of cat, it can be identified through the sounds. Now, what is the difference between our sound and animal sound?
Your speech.
Our sound is in form of a language.
Form of language. So we speak. We just don't make sounds. This is not shouting. This is speaking. And you get to know about it. You understand it. Because you also know the meaning of this kind of sound, language or word. So we create the articulate sound. And this is possible because of our rationality. We have reason, which is not there in animals. Now, they talk about the IQ of animals and they say an elephant or chimpanzee, they have higher levels of intelligent quotients. But all this, whatever higher quotients of animals, they are largely restricted to their natural instincts. And human rationality or human IQ is not related to only natural instincts, it is related to the rationality. So, we can create science, we have created science, we have created language, we have created varieties of subjects for knowing the world. See, economics and sociology and psychology, these are not natural sciences. They are all the ways in which we can know the activities of social activities of human person. So this is the height of human rationality. But is that all? What other thing human person can create?
Madam, have we created science or we discovered science?
Humans have
the
discovered.
See, discovered the things. Scientists will also say that the things are there in the nature. But someone has to speak about it. Someone has to make a law about it. And that is what is called as science. Law of thought is not the creation of logic. But there is need of logic to know the law of thought. Science is this kind of creation of human person. There are certain inventions and there are certain discoveries. But creativity and systematization is the human activity. It is not given in nature. That is how we say science means demystifying the nature. Nature itself doesn't get demystified. We have to demystify it. And that is what we do. But apart from science and other products of rationality, what else can be created by human person?
Imagination.
Or thinking.
Thinking. But rationality means thinking. Even imagination is part of thinking, though not connected to the truth.
Peace of mind. Interaction.
Peace of mind.
How will we get it?
Meditation.
Interaction.
There are different levels of mind, like subconscious mind, that way, which human beings understand. Difference from the animals.
Does anyone do meditation? Very good. So what do you do in meditation? you have to speak out.
Which means just observe your breath.
Thoughtless.
The breath, body, and then try and reach a level of thoughtlessness.
Thoughtlessness is meditation.
So thoughtlessness.
No, not thoughtlessness. This is zero state of mind. So basically you try and reach a level where you know how to control your thoughts, that you know when to stop it, when to make it, when to
observe,
when to leave it, when to take it. So, that you
say. So controlled thoughtlessness is meditation.
So we go beyond our rationality, isn't it? See, stopping the thought or controlling the thought is going beyond rationality. So there also we have the capacity to transcend.
Yes.
And one very best example of this going beyond is that by knowing that I am in this body, I am living in this world, a human person can ask this question: who am I? So we can have a big description of who am I, but that is not something that satisfies that person. We want our real identity, something which is not confined to this body, this world, and this all the kind of material thing. So going beyond, and that is somehow named as spirituality. Spirituality doesn't mean only moksha, but it is something which is going beyond. We, all of us, we have that ability, and through that only many religions, cultures, philosophies, and all these creative endeavors have been created by human person. So these dimensions, we have body, so we have sense organs, we have mind to express our emotions, we have rationality to create the science, and we have spirituality to even make sense of religion and certain other creative factors which are lying around us. This whole idea completes the human person. Now you may say, why only this? It's quite possible. So there could be some other dimension, but that we have to articulate. We have certain limits because we have body. And just one very funny example. We know that we all have 5 sense organs. We know them, no?
Yes.
We have 5 sense organs. Suppose God is great and God says, dear person, I want to give you 6 sense organs. What will we ask for?
Knowing other persons.
That is not a sense organ. Can you see mind?
Instincts.
That is not a sense organ. See, sense organ is something which is a part of body.
6th sense.
And which will have, but that is not part of body. 6th sense is intuition.
Intuition. Instincts.
Sense organ is something which is a part of body and which will have a particular sense field, as eyes can see and tongue can taste. What kind of 6th organ we will have?
Tentacles.
And what will they?
Antenna.
Danger.
What will they?
Transmit.
It will sense danger.
So actually, we don't need only, because God has made us perfect with 5 senses.
Wow. That is a very wonderful expression.
He just
see, this is a very good expression, but this we say because we cannot conceptualize the 6th sense organ.
Correct. Because we have not experienced.
We don't know what could be the 6th sense field.
Agree.
Yes.
So this is in a way our limit. But this is our strength also, because we have maximum number of sense organs. In the available animals, we have the maximum number. And then, along with that, we have rationality by which we can go beyond. We can even think of this 6th sense organ.
Color change karta tha animals. Yeah, animals can change their colors.
That is also my instinct, no defense. The camouflage.
Human beings also change colors.
So they have, certain mechanism for defense. Now our brain is our highest mechanism for defense, by which we can rule the nature. Now with this, it gives us very interesting thought about what do we know. Yeah. Read the last point, or maybe second, and read the whole slide. Reality means the object of knowledge. What we know is called as reality. This bottle is a reality. This remote is a reality. Reality is anything that exists. But. It may be one or many or manifold. It may be empirical, that means given to senses, or beyond that. The last point is something which is very important for us. Whether reality is independent or constructed is very crucial question in epistemology. Now you tell me your opinion about it. We call it now opinion, safely, no?
Reality
so
has to
it
be
did not be true or false.
Reality has to be independent.
It is constructed. It keeps on changing over a period of time.
Reality is reality.
How do we know that reality is independent?
It is there. It is real.
It is not dependent on something.
If we start constructing, it is not independent.
Any other external factor cannot.
And what do we mean by constructing?
Artificial.
Imagining, artificial. It's
given an example.
You're probably using two, three different situations.
Be flat. That was a reality then. Today, Earth is round. It is a reality today.
So you have to counter him. He is saying that reality is constructed.
I'm saying it is constructed. Because it changes the time. Or with very
is
better
earth,
understanding.
Is Earth flat or round?
It is round. Nobody has constructed it. God has constructed.
Constructed doesn't mean constructing
constructed.
The building. But actually, knowledge is like building.
Yeah.
We construct the building of knowledge. There are some foundations. Then there are some floors, and then we go to the top. So it is the same model like a building, but this is all conceptual, not physical.
So
now coming to the question of reality, how do we, if this one, is it independent or constructed?
Present,
I say this is a bottle.
Presently it is independent.
Water is independent.
Huh?
No, present as it is, as a bottle, as water, it is independent. Unless we don't manipulate it, it is independent.
It is related to reference.
Is it even knowledge?
Huh?
Is it even knowledge?
Ma'am, the reality that the earth is round will remain. But our knowledge about earth was not right. There was a fall in the knowledge about
that.
The
was, that was probably an opinion that Earth is flat.
That was a knowledge then.
They thought it is knowledge, but that was an opinion.
Correct. So today what we think is knowledge, 100, 200 years down the line.
Knowledge keeps changing.
Yes.
Knowledge changes with more discovery. Knowledge can change.
So
knowledge changes means our understanding of the reality
changes.
Changes.
Yes. But reality
that
is reality.
The construction of reality changes.
Yes. But the reality remains reality.
Remains real.
How do we know?
Only the construction
now
changes.
Now see, some thousand years before, someone said Earth is flat.
Yes.
Then the science comes and says Earth is round. Maybe after some 300 years, someone will
triangle.
Come and say Earth is
triangle.
No, Earth is Earth. How do we verify it?
You say saying that mind, body and the soul are different. How do we verify that the soul is different?
But we are not saying like mind and body. Earth is earth. Earth is not made, mind and body.
Proof is produced. Nowadays
yeah, so there is proof about it.
Proof as
knowledge.
Knowledge is science.
It's verified.
Science
it's verified.
Help of experiments.
Knowledge is not just science.
It's real. It's
knowledge
real.
Is science and something else.
Information.
Only scientific model of knowledge is very limited. Science is one part of that. Who will see when we say some proofs were given? Now all these proofs about our theories are in a way justification.
Yeah, verification.
For that theory. So in the justification, what are we doing? We are not just testing the truth. We are giving our reasons for saying that.
So can we say that knowledge is always there, but it is our perception which changes the knowledge?
It is our understanding.
Knowledge itself is
because our perception keeps changing. The more deeper we go, our perception keeps changing. The perception of the earth being flat or round changed with knowledge.
What knowledge?
Knowledge is knowing.
Knowledge, what a fine.
Knowledge is a very $1 million word now.
Knowledge is knowing.
Knowing.
Reality is reality. Reality doesn't change. Knowledge changes.
But our gateway to reality is our knowledge.
Yeah.
So knowledge changes. Reality changes.
No, reality doesn't change.
Today our reality is that there are 9 planets. Tomorrow we may discover 2 more planets. Then the reality
so
will change.
But the gateway to reality is not knowledge. Our gateway to reality is the information which is fed into
that's
come out of the knowledge. That information.
See, now you play with those words in any method. We don't know. What we know, see information.
How much you know is
the
knowledge.
Moment until the moment that information doesn't become my information.
Correct.
It has no value for me. So the gateway that I open to reality. Is only through knowledge.
Absolutely.
So what is there? According to me, it is what I know is there. And what I don't know
is also there.
Yeah, it's that much openness I should have. Yeah, knowledge teaches us that openness. Knowledge doesn't make you absolute. Rather, knowledge makes you humble. That so far I know only this much.
Absolutely.
But there may be lot of thing beyond. Do we know that story of elephant and 6 blind people?
Yeah.
That's a good model. Not for perception, but for knowledge. Now, if you want a narration, I can give, but I don't think narration is required. What the message that story gives us is that our, in a way, our perception of the reality depends upon our conditions. And we take it to be the truth. If we change the perspective, it changes. Is it opposite to the previous one?
It is a shifting of the process.
Yeah, it is a shifting of the process. But is it the case that earlier was wrong and new is right?
No, that was also an opinion.
Opinion. Yeah. So all of
right
the knowledge boils down to opinion.
Like there is a paradigm shift.
See, if we say earlier was opinion and later also opinion, then all of our knowledge will come down to the level of opinion.
No. Knowledge is knowledge.
Don't make it opinion.
So that we know what we know and that
yes.
We do
knowledge
not
is
know
based
what
on
we
certain
know.
Understanding.
Yes,
alone
I know
moment.
That I don't know
that we know what we know.
You are right.
Now we say, I don't know that I don't know. It's very dangerous. I know that I don't know
is
natural.
Yes, which one?
And I know that I know is normal. Isn't it?
Yes.
We all know what we know. But very few know what they don't know. Or that they don't know something.
Or they don't know that they don't know.
That is
dangerous.
That is very different category. See, see here, so when we come to this idea of the object, all these statements become very meaningful and important for us, because what we call as the object of knowledge is not 100% outside. What we know is partly constructed by us, though not fully. Something is given. Say, when we say there is a bottle, something is standing there in front of me. But whether this is like this or not, I don't know whether it really is like this. Some science students said in the class, when we say this is a green color, in fact, this is anything else but green color. That means this is not really a green color, but it is appearing to us as green. So the reality of that color is something different. And we go by appearance. But can we go beyond our appearance?
We don't need to know.
We have to.
We have to.
This is something. No.
This
when
is
we say,
green,
can we
you
go?
See it, we all see it as green, so it is real.
It is appearing to be
green.
So it is real. That is what is reality.
And our knowledge is saying this is green.
What is the truth? What is the
You are talking about the name of that color.
No.
I am not talking about the name of the color. I am talking about that very concept of color. And color that appears to our eyes is something which is anything else but that color.
Yes.
This is what science says.
Yes.
Absence of
photo. That is all refraction of light and all that.
Exactly.
Those all theoretical things.
We go with what appears to us. Correct? We accept it, what appears to us. And for us, it is piece of knowledge.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Well, somewhere I read that, you know, why we call this as a green or blue or orange, because whenever we look at a particular color, certain kind of feelings come in a human mind.
See, that is quite possible. And all our language is a combination of rationality, emotion, etc., etc. That's not doubted at all. What we have to learn about the relation between me and the object. See, there is no one particular theory. See, science can go with one theory, law of gravitation. Now, any scientist will, law of gravitation is in a way universal theory. No one will challenge it. But in philosophical paradigms, there is no such universality. So there will be different paradigms talking about the relation between the person and the object of knowledge. And they are very important for us because we are in the field of implementing knowledge. You, in your previous lectures, I don't know what you learned about
epistemology is theory of knowledge. Nothing more.
No, but these words were not there. Praman, etc.
That was just introduction.
So, how many of us know about Jainism?
Yet to learn.
One of the nine
philosophers.
But there in theory, in practice, don't you know anything about Jainism?
Yes, yes.
They started fasting from today. They start their fasting from today.
They don't have garlic. And then every Jain will keep telling you, pardon me.
Bhulchukma.
Yeah, so this is about Jain religion, and we have a lot of population of. Anyone Jain here?
Oh yeah, yes. Multiple.
You should say something.
Achha.
What is it?
You're not a Jain?
What is it?
Jain kar diya.
Kaltakal Jain. See, Jainism we know as a religion.
It's a science.
Jainism?
Yes. It's a
science-based.
It is a science.
Every religion is a science.
But if
like that, every religion is a science.
The process that is laid down of how to live your life, and if you look at it, if you correlate it with the scientific.
Agree.
You have to, when you wake up in the morning, you
cannot have a, you should not be having your breakfast before, you know, sunrise, or you should have it 45 minutes to 48 minutes after sunrise. So there is a reason behind it. Then 48 minutes before sunset, you should finish your dinner. So there is a reason behind it. So for everything, there is a reason. One drop of water consists of thousands of microorganisms is defined in Jainism way back. So all this has been defined, and that is why the religion says that this, the whole crux of the religion is you try to minimize as much harm as you can cause to the nature and live your life. Live and let live.
See, science generally doesn't give you prescriptions like should or shouldn't.
It's a way of life. Jainism is a way of life.
Yeah.
Everybody who follows the principles laid out in Jainism will be a Jain. He need not be born a Jain. Same way is in Hinduism. We are not entering into the debate. Religion, I know. I'm telling from what I know. So I'm sure ma'am knows much better than me.
There is nothing like knowing better or knowing worse or anything. See, when we talk about Jainism,
this is knowledge and this is reality.
Because Jain say that earth is of the shape of human person. So now it is obviously not a scientific statement, but their way of looking at the world. See, their image of the world is like this, no? The person standing the hands on the waist. So that is their idea of the world. Now this is a statement which has some maybe religious or spiritual motive, and that is how they explain their cosmology, etc. But one of the important theories that Jainism gives us is termed as Anekantavad. Anekantavad is the view which can be translated as not one-sidedness or multi-sidedness. According to them, reality is first of all many in number. There is no one reality. There are many realities, and all of them are many-sided. Just example, we are one reality. Now we, as we are here appearing to everyone, we are the living body. And they say that every body has a soul. That means soul is there in every life. Why we call something as a living body? Because there is soul. Soul is something which is eternal. Body dies, of course soul doesn't die. But soul requires some body to exist. So the phases of many bodies is changing. And this is happening right from the first time, or maybe the beginning of the world. So our journey is very long back. At present we are born as humans. Maybe after death we will be something else, depending upon our count of karma, sins and merits, etc. And that is baggage also, previous. Is reality permanent or changing?
Changing.
But they will say it is both. It is permanent also, because soul is eternal. Soul will not be born, soul will not be dying.
But soul is again an opinion. Soul is an opinion.
Doesn't matter. They are philosophy, no? They are free to have
opinion. How can it be real? Opinion is again subjective, right?
It's a metaphor.
Doesn't matter. What is your worry? I am telling you Jaina opinion about the reality. Is it okay?
No.
This is what we call as a paradigm. So paradigms are in a way larger or more constructed opinions. Individual opinion could be very spontaneous. But philosophies are well constructed opinions only. And that is why they all can be there together, fighting with each other and not changing oneself. Isn't it? This doesn't seem to be there in science. Because science deals with the empirical fact. Philosophy doesn't deal, philosophy or religion doesn't deal with the fact. As you all say, it is a way of life. So they will say everything that is making something as a very sound way of life. So they will not go with any absolute description of the reality. They will say from one side, from one perspective, reality is permanent also. And from other perspective, reality is changing also. Are we real or not? But we are temporary. So if we look at it, reality from the individual perspective, it is temporary. If we look at reality as some final principle, it is permanent. It is both. It is permanent also and changing or temporary also. And this kind of combination, relativism, is applicable to everything. Now how do we express our knowledge of reality? We express the knowledge of reality through some kind of statements. So every statement that we make about reality is partially true, because we belong to or we adopt one perspective. Now we can say we are conducting the class in the seminar room. We are conducting the class in Bajaj Bhavan. We are conducting the class in Vidyanagari campus. We are conducting the class in Mumbai. Is any statement incorrect?
No, all are correct. All correct.
All are correct, but they depend upon one's perspective. So this is according to them, the truth related to knowledge. All that we know depends upon our perspective. And through our perspective, we try to construct, theoretically construct, the object of knowledge. Now, we are we, that means that idea of the knower, having the physical dimension, having biological dimension, psychological, rational, spiritual, everything is there. But I do live with certain kind of conditionality. I am born in India. I am born as a woman. Then I am educated like this. All this is like a conditioning. So I will have certain perspective to understand the reality. I can change the perspective. I am free to do that. But I need to accept this fact that I do have certain conditioning in understanding everything. Do we need a break?
2 minutes break.
क्या तुमको भी मजा नहीं आएगा, मेरे को भी नहीं आएगा.
यहाँ पर खाली पैकेट आएगा.
Oh,
क्या करें? क्या करें? क्या?
टेम्परेचर बढ़ाया, थोड़ा कूलिंग ज़्यादा हो गया ना,
इतना स्ट्रॉन्ग
स्ट्रॉन्ग आया था ना,
बहुत स्ट्रॉन्ग
कम कर दिया।
हाँ ठीक है, becomes knowledge.
Now we cannot drive.
तो अभी से आगे मत बोलना, लाल बोलना।
When we were talking about the break, obviously there were minimum two groups in the class.
Yes.
Because our perspectives were different.
So they did not know our reality, no? Then we had to go there.
And you don't know their reality. You don't know their priority. See, it all depends upon the priority. Or the preference that we give. And this priority preference emerges from our conditioning. See, we don't like to call ourselves as being conditioned, but we are largely conditioned.
Yes.
And see, this is something that we were talking some time before, that we should know what we are knowing and we must know what we are not knowing also. So what we don't know is something beyond our conditioning. Jaina paradigm says that every person is conditioned, but there is possibility of changing that conditioning, and knowing that we are conditioned is really the truth. So truth is something to know our limitations on one hand, and truth is also to know that the object of knowledge is multifaceted. What we know is only part of that. If everything is both permanent and changing, what we know about the reality is only part, not the whole. So our knowledge is limited, our knowledge is conditioned, and it is emerging from our perspective. Is it correct to change the perspective?
Yes.
Or some correct?
If it is, yeah. Means first I had a perspective that the earth is flat. Now I have a perspective that the earth is round. So I have changed.
It's not your perspective, that's knowledge.
Perception.
People have told you.
With truth.
This is knowledge.
Do we know? there is one thing that the philosophers say. How do we derive knowledge? Can we talk about sources of knowledge?
Yes.
Yeah? What are they?
Information, education, influence,
observation. These are, these are recorded. All external sources. Yeah.
Sense organs.
But we have to see.
Your sense organs will derive the knowledge.
So we have one major source called perception.
Yeah.
The other source called reasoning. And third major source called word, language. But thinkers say that more than 70% of our knowledge we get through language or some word,
exchange,
testimony.
Exchange, yeah.
See, these are our parents. This is the very basic knowledge that we have. And it is not by perception or reasoning.
What is the difference between perception and reasoning?
Perception is given to sense.
Reasoning, because reasoning is also comes from perception.
It may be based on, but it is going beyond that. Reasoning is using our concepts or maybe connecting the concepts to each other. In some other lecture, we will talk about the sources of knowledge, because that is again another basic. So more than 70% knowledge comes from the testimony, and we accept it. Very few of it is based on perception, because perception is something which is present to our sense organs. So it's very limited. Reasoning can extend perception, because it can connect perception to memory, it can connect perception to any concept and all other things. But everywhere the knowledge and the object relation is so different and very relative to a particular type of knowledge. So it is, according to Jainism, it is something which is important to accept the relativity, conditionality and partiality of knowledge, because reality cannot be grasped in its full by a limited human person. We are very limited and reality is very vast. So what is the benefit of this kind of paradigm? Because see, we are the people, that means you are the people, not me. I am a teacher. So I go with, as Radha sir said, knowledge for the sake of knowledge. But you people will be doing something on the basis of this. You will implement this idea somewhere in your decision making. So does it have its impact on decision making? Think about it. You have one perspective when you are taking some decision. But maybe you know the limitations, you come to know the limitations, you may change the perspective. And your whole decision process changes. There is a very, maybe, striking change in the entire process of decision making. So it's quite possible that person-to-person relations, for you the other person is only the object. See, for everyone, anyone else than me is the object. So I am conceptually constructing the object. And on the basis of my conceptual construction, I am taking some decisions. So if my construction changes, the decision will also change. Is it a limitation or is it a freedom?
Freedom.
Are you getting what I am saying? Or it is going very tangent? Or you are contemplating or meditating? What are you doing? Please give some kind of reaction.
We are trying to grasp.
Little tangent.
Building on something.
We are thinking what you are saying.
We are afraid to reply that if we might be wrong.
That is why everyone is very serious. I never thought it was so serious. I thought it is very...
Okay, everybody is defensive.
See, this is what I thought about the relation between knowledge and decision making, and I had to work on it because that is not how we look at the point. But this is what I feel. It allows to expand the idea of agent. Agent means the subject, person. So agent is not a single dimensional person. Agent is having many dimensions, but agent is with some kind of limitations as well as some kind of strength. See, our conditioning is our limitation, but our awareness of our own conditioning can be our freedom. So we can change ourselves. If we want, we can change ourselves. And our change is not only change for ourselves. Our change is the change for the others. And this change takes place because we are knowing other living persons. We are not again receiving only passively. We are reacting, we are responding to the world around us. And the world which is full of persons around us, we are responding. So through their responses or through our responses to them, lot of interaction is taking place and agent gets enriched. But this enrichment results into the change of conditioning for that agent. We can change ourselves. We can expand the field of knowledge. We can know our own limitations. We can know the limitations of our knowledge. But we can convert them into our strength. See, this is the skill of you. This is the rationality. See, all those Paralympic players, they are so full with limitations. They are physically handicapped. But they converted that limitation into their strength. Now, we are people with full bodies and a good sense, good reason. Can't it be our strength? This is a change of perspective that is allowed by a theory of knowledge. See, if we know what is knowledge, if we know the idea of what do we know, how do we know, and what is there to know, and then our own relation to that object of knowledge, all these kind of revisions and formulations, reformulations, many permutations and combinations are possible. But this is not like a prescription. That means even though it is a Jaina paradigm, don't take it as a religious, it is not a religious paradigm, it is purely knowledge paradigm. So Jainism is only to give you the reference from where it got emerged. And this idea of multi-sidedness or many-sidedness is in a way very prone to the expansion or enrichment of our knowledge. But again, this is not one paradigm. Buddhism will say about it in a very different way. And today, what do we know about Buddhism? Today we will not discuss it. But do we know anything about Buddhism?
Very close to Jainism.
And someone will say very far away from Jainism.
Jainism is a little stricter. Buddhism is a little more
linear,
flexible, and
it believes in impermanence.
More permissive. More permissive.
Everything is we ourselves. Yeah. That is what Buddhism is. That there is no external God. Everything is within us. We are only God, and
but that is really just part. In the field of philosophy, it has something very important to say about knowledge. So that we will learn somewhere when Radha sir will permit us.
Law of impermanence.
Sorry?
Impermanence.
Law of impermanence. Impermanence. This is one side. And Jainism says there cannot be only impermanence. Every impermanence will have something permanent. So Jainism is more relative or relativistic, while Buddhism will have its own middle path. See, philosophies with middle path or philosophies with non-absolutism, they have given very important contribution to to the concept of knowledge. So today we tried to explore the Jaina concept along with the general ideas of knowledge. And whenever the time permits, we will go with some other paradigm of knowledge. Oh my God, I made them silent.
You put us into thinking, ma'am.
Very good. So next time you are going to defeat me when we start Buddhism. Every time you have to say, but this is your perspective.
Yeah, we thought we have some knowledge, but now we don't know what is knowledge.
We know now what we do.
We
will travel as spouses.
I'll just add on to what Meenal ma'am said. I understand where you are coming from, I understand where ma'am comes from. See, when you look at this subject on knowledge management, okay, let me go to some basics. It is not like finance management, it is not like marketing management, it is not like project management. Please understand this basic, because the syllabus में देखते हो तो knowledge management लगता है कि कुछ तो knowledge का हम लोग management करेंगे वो सब utility value. So finance management समझ में आता है ना, you have accounts and that is finance management. Project management, you're doing a project, how to manage it. But don't confuse that with knowledge management. First things first. What we are trying to do is that we are going to the word knowledge itself and how to manage it. पहला बेसिक समझ लो, देन वी विल बी एबल टू कनेक्ट टू व्हाट शी सेड. फर्स्ट इज वी आर गोइंग टू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज नॉलेज, एंड नॉलेज इटसेल्फ टू गेट ऑर्गेनाइज्ड देयर आर मेनी थियोरीज एंड दैट इज कॉल्ड एपिस्टेमोलॉजी. थियोरीज ऑफ नॉलेज व्हिच गेट स्ट्रक्चर्ड टू वेरियस प्लेसेस, राइट? नाउ अंडरस्टैंड फॉर हाउ मेनी पीपल एपिस्टेमोलॉजी इटसेल्फ इज अ फर्स्ट टाइम वर्ड. वी विल गो इनटू दैट लेटर ऑन. नाउ इफ यू लुक एट अ कंपनी एंड इट इज डूइंग नॉलेज मैनेजमेंट, ओके, how does a common man perceive it? There are hundreds of books we are managing and keeping in the shelf, right? Yeah. But it is still organizing the books, the CDs, the data, the emails, isn't it? So there is something called as KPO. What is KPO?
Knowledge
processing outsourcing. You have heard that?
Yes.
KPO, BPO, yeah. Business process outsourcing. But let me come back. This is not the way we are looking at knowledge. First things first, okay? So, knowledge management is not organizing the knowledge in the forms. So, I am not organizing books. I am not organizing data. I am not organizing CDs. I am not organizing Google Drive also. Okay? Now, I am going to the very basic fundamental of knowledge kya hai. And if you remember, Shubhda Joshi ma'am so beautifully said one day, we have the systems in India which unfortunately we have forgotten that they have spent centuries only to define what is knowledge. What is knowledge? 600 years. After generation after generation after. And the outcome of that is the darshanas that we call. Okay? Now let me come back where ma'am said that this is from the concept of Jainism. Now if you look at the Jain, unfortunately for us, Jaina, as she said, it's a religion, right? Buddhism is a religion. No, it became a religion with set practices. But the original founders thought about the concept of what is knowledge, what is truth. Samajh gaya? Like Gandhiji said, now my experiments with truth. Because we'll come back to the basics that all these are from the dimension of philosophy. And man said, we'll first look at Jainism angle today. Later on, we can look at Buddhism angle. There could be a Vedanta angle. There could be hundreds of angles. Now, this is within Indian systems only. Huh? How many darshanas are there?
9.
6 plus 3. Lokayata. They also thought about knowledge. Charvakas are the Lokayatas. Nyaya, Sankhya, Yoga. So I understand none of you come from the philosophy background, right? So some of these terminologies could be new. But I would like to say that let us go back and ma'am will be back again. Not only that I will call you, but you know, probably we will debate more, because the thing is that yahan pe kya ho raha hai, we are at the highest space of knowledge to understand knowledge and then categorize it and all this. That is a later process. But let me ask you one simple question so that you can have a thought as you go back. Let me ask you, if you were in the dimension of understanding truth, okay? Truth, one simple word. Should you know the truth? And if so, why? Why should you know the truth?
That
the correct perception.
But okay, one simple question. Why should you know the truth?
To build your knowledge.
Okay.
To take a decision, to do a judgment, whatever.
Okay. Anything else? Why should you know the truth?
What a question.
The thing is that we are still looking at truth from an application angle.
Yeah.
One dimension of truth, I want to know for the sake of truth.
Yeah. If it is truth, it should be known.
That's it. So this is a philosophical angle. Abhi dekho, aapne bola, why should you know the truth? To judge a person, to take a decision, to an application. Samajh rahe ho? So, let me ask you one question. Why should you have knowledge?
No.
To pehla aapka seedha external jata hai. Saying that I should, you know, first of all, which knowledge? Knowledge of the mobile, knowledge of the object, knowledge of a science like physics, chemistry, math, which is, as she beautifully pointed out, they're all scientific knowledge which can be seen and perceived, physical. But yahan pe thoda change ho jata hai. The knowledge is not about something. It is about knowledge itself. So when you go inside, the question itself changes. It is not application based. Okay, therefore, very beautifully she put it over there that when you look at, there are four dimensions which very nicely explained. Physical level knowledge, mind level which is psychological, intellectual, and spiritual. अभी तक हमारा लिमिटेशन क्या है लीडरशिप लेवल पे अभी हम लोग देखते हैं फिजिकल लेवल पे लोगों का प्रजा का ऑल दोस थिंग्स इज फाइन अभी वी आर इन द साइकोलॉजिकल पार्ट ऑफ इट नॉट साइकोलॉजी ऑफ अदर्स हां स्टिल विद अस देन इंटेलेक्चुअल देन फाइनली द स्पिरिचुअल वी विल हैव दिस डिस्कशन लेटर ऑन एंड आई विल रिक्वेस्ट मैम टू कम बैक एंड डिबेट ऑन ऑल दोस थिंग्स बट आई लाइक टू जस्ट से दैट यू नो ऑन अ वेरी वेरी ऑर्गेनाइज्ड एकेडमिक वर्ल्ड इट हैज बीन कैटेगराइज्ड इनटू फिजिकल एंड मेटाफिजिकल What is metaphysical which cannot be seen, perceived, understood, it can't be measured directly.
It's abstract.
It's abstract. So philosophy, many people perceive, is abstract. But the fact is that once you go to the abstract and understood, you can come back to the application level. It is not that it is not applicable. But problem kya hai, hum sirf application sochenge na, we'll never be able to understand the real essence. So isliye Swami Vivekananda put it very nicely, practical Vedanta. Actually it's contradictory. Vedanta samajh gaya to it's over. But then these saints who realize the self come back to serve the world, isn't it? In every religion, in every community. And in the Gita it's called Loka Sangra. I have found out the truth. Wow. So let me tell the people what the truth is. But unko samajh mein nahi aata hai. So that theek hai. Truth lekar ke tumko prayas karna padega, namaz karna padega, aarti karna padega. So, but the idea is not to get stuck over there. The idea is to go back to that. Coming back, when we talk about knowledge management, we will come back to the application and the other thing. But here we are going to the pure philosophy of what is knowledge. So I would like to just leave over here saying that agar upar se gaya hai, iska matlab ye nahi ki, the idea is that basically please understand this concept. I think the good part is that it has been already given to you. Iske upar jo words hai na, thoda uspe soch ke aaye. Now as Shubhta ma'am also said, and this is only one dimension of truth. Now think about it. People have been only discussing what is knowledge, what is knowledge, what is knowledge for centuries. They found it also. And now there is another dimension. Jaina ho gaya, Buddhism ho gaya, you keep going on and on and on. My dear friends, I would like to tell you that ek bar samajh mein aa gaya na, application easy ho jayega. And really speaking, it is the pure scientific knowledge which becomes application knowledge. Jaise maine do cheez bataya, fundamental research and application
level.
प्योर साइंस है अप्लाइड साइंस तो थोड़ा इसमें प्योर साइंस है प्योर नॉलेज है बट आई एम श्योर दैट यू विल स्टार्ट थिंकिंग अबाउट ऑल दीज एंगल्स एंड यू हैव मीनल मैम अगेन कमिंग बैक एंड यू गिविंग अस सम मोर डायमेंशंस टू दिस सो दैट वी कैन एक्सप्लोर नॉलेज फ्रॉम द एंगल ऑफ नॉलेज मैम सर क्लोजिंग वर्ड्स
So we know something, no?
Yeah. And we know what we don't know.
At least we know that we don't know something.
Yes.
Many this much things. Understanding, yes. This much realization is fantastic. Correct. So we meet sometime else.
Yes.
Chetan, do we have a PPT?